This is not only our anniversary and a birthday, but it's also Palm Sunday, which marks when Jesus was celebrated as he rode into Jerusalem. And you know what that happened to him the week later. But
yes, we do.
But he's also our example of the greatest shepherd and the greatest leader that ever walked the earth. So what lessons, since it is Palm Sunday, what lessons can you take away from Jesus' ministry and time on earth during that week?
Okay.
Well, I told her, don't make them deep. I'm not a deep person. So I can come up with something, but it's going to take a minute. No. I was actually reading something about Palm Sunday this morning. And it was, I thought about how the people were praising him, you know, so much. And then, like you said, it turned. But then, and this may or may not fit that, but when he was on the cross and he said, Father, forgive them. That spoke to me when people are coming against you. If I could do this myself, if I could take that and turn that around that quick and say, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. And that spoke to me this morning just as I was reading a devotion. So, yeah.
I agree. I think that's the greatest lesson out of Palm Sunday. I was rereading it yesterday myself, and you know, there was quite a praise going on when Jesus came into Jerusalem. You know, there's cutting the palm branches where we get the term Palm Sunday, laying their clothes out there for them to come in on. And a couple of lessons, I agree with what BB's saying. If we just learn to condition ourselves as soon as someone offends us, offense is going to come. That's scriptural. It just does. It's up to us whether we take it. As John Bevere put it in a book, The Bait of Satan. I mean, it's our decision. Your decision, my decision, whether we take it. Jesus wouldn't take it. He didn't even take it the night he's betrayed. Judas was, you know, stabbing him in the back, and he's still giving him his bread and his wine for the communion. And but the other lesson I took away as I was looking at it too is Zechariah in, I think it's chapter 6 or chapter 9, said your king will come riding on a donkey. I love that. And the reason I love that, he prophesied it all those years before, and it still happened. Well, here's the thing about the Word of God. Whatever God said, it'll come to pass. It doesn't matter what the naysayers say. Now, Scripture we know to be a fact, but if God spoke a word in your heart, you hold on to it. The devil can't take that. All we can do is release it and not go after it. Whatever God said he would do, he will do. And so be quick to forgive and step into what God's showing you for your life.
Y'all started a church and blended a family all within a 3-year time span.
Yes, we did.
Which is easier, and how are they alike?
Well, these easy questions, aren't they?
Sure, I'm just going to lay down now. Just to go back in my mind.
Let me jump on that one first. Let me correct one term that I think somebody was having fun when they came up with. A blended family. That sounds really smooth and sweet. Okay, I like to look at it this way. You throw a bunch of people together that don't know each other, you got to figure out how to keep from killing one another. And I mean, we had our moments, but we've been blessed with such a good family, our kids, and but the church is kind of the same way. You just figure out how you're going to roll, and you just roll. That's why I was telling my team, even Friday, I said, I've never wrestled with the fact that I was called here. Things happen. People come and go. You hit highs, you hit lows. But I never have questioned because God told me to come do it. And and same with your family. God told you that you were the mom, the dad, whatever the case may be, and you just make a decision. This is how I'm going to roll, and then love people, forgive people, move forward. And but to me, there's a lot of similarities that I've seen.
To me, the church was hardest because I was scared. Mm-hmm. I was scared of that title, pastor's wife. I was terrified of that. Asia was with me. I don't know where you're at. Asia. There you are. We had went with them to the beach, and she stopped at the church where Ed and Tammy were, and she introduced me as her pastor's wife, and I was about
about
fame. Don't say that to me, because I had this image, and the only way I can get through stuff like that is, God, you know who I am, I can't be something I'm not, and so I just have to be me. And so that was the hardest for me. For the family, a lot of y'all know, we only dated 4 months and we got married. So
how long?
4 months. We didn't hardly know each other longer than that. So I was a kid of 70s TV. I watched TV all the time. If your kids watch TV a lot, don't worry about it, because now I work all the time, never watch TV. So it does, you do get it out early maybe, but I watch TV all the time. Brady's Bunch and all these. So I just figured, you know, everything works out. And so I went into it, and it was tough because we didn't know each other, the family part. But we were blessed with good kids, so, and I'm thankful for that. And God give us some wisdom on how to deal with it. But the church was by far scarier for me.
Yeah. Back to one thing real quick. You know, I say it.
Up and down.
I was saying that you decide how you're going to roll. One of the lessons, and many of you have heard this testimony, Bibi sat there in the house she moved into. I'd been there since we're still there. I've been there since I was five. She knew me 4 months. She's living there. I'm at work from daylight to dark with Bowles Furniture at the time. And she's sitting there one day, and she asked the Lord, she said, "What am I doing here?" Mm-hmm. That's a good question. He said, "I called you here to keep things together." And she's been doing that ever since. Mm-hmm. And many of you have heard that testimony. But I still remember the unwise decision I made when Adam and Nick, we were going to put them, they didn't know each other. Mm-hmm. And they weren't in love.
No.
We didn't know each other, but we were in love. Okay, big difference. And but we made the decision, Nick, you remember this, put them in the same bedroom.
Nick lost his room.
Bibi come home one day and they're at the top of the staircase fighting.
Slugging it out.
And of course, Mama put her foot down. She said, "They're going to be fighting around here. I'm doing it."
That kind of fight, anyway, it scared me, because yeah. I was afraid they was going to knock each other down the steps.
But the point of it was they never did anymore. Mm-hmm. Now, we did get them out of the room. We did wise. She spoke into my life and said, "This is ridiculous," you know. But again, find out what God's calling you to do and roll with it. This is huge. Mm. On this Palm Sunday, Jesus, the Bible says when he went to the cross, we'll be celebrating next week, Easter. I love this passage where it says he set his face like a flint. You can throw stones at me. You can criticize the way I do it. It really doesn't matter. God told me to do it this way. And when you get that attitude, nobody can stop you. See, Satan can't stop you. All he can do is hinder your thinking. If he could stop you, he'd have done took you out. Because he hates you. I remember the first revelation the Lord gave me 20 years ago when I entered the ministry. He said, "Always remember this. Satan can't stop them, but he can make them so miserable in it nobody wants to join them." Don't let Satan do that. You stay in the Word. You get your face set like a flint and watch God do exceedingly abundantly above everything. Go ahead. I won't make you sit back down.
Y'all had 36 people at your first service at Ellis Park on April 14th, 2002. What was that first year like? And did you ever look at each other and wonder if you'd missed God?
You want to go first?
The first year, I remember, I guess it was 4 months that we were at Ellis Park.
Mm-hmm. Three or four.
I don't know. I'm just a simple person, I guess. But when the Lord told him to start the church, after I got over the fear of being the pastor's wife, I just told him, I said, "Well, we can do this." Our rent was $25 a month. And I don't think long term, okay? I'm just like, what have we got today? And I told him, I said, "Our tithe will pay that. So we can do that." So, and then we're just going to see. I never really doubted that it would work. And that first year, because we had young kids, Adam and Nick were 12. Chad was 17, so it's a little bit different. But Chad's always left out because he's older. But it was still important to me for the 12-year-olds to have something fun at church. We'd pulled them out from Agape Faith, where they had a lot going on, and I was concerned that they would be bored with church. And so, even though I was mama, I took them out and I tried to do something with the kids. I remember Thurman Asia's granddaughter, Jessica. It was a long time getting her in there, but she finally come back there with me. And so my goal at that point was to have something for the kids. It meant a lot to me. I knew he had the rest, and that was just my thinking. But I never really doubted that it would succeed, because in my world, when you do something, you just do it, and it works. I don't know. So.
Yeah, and that was a lot of encouragement to me the first time I heard her say that, because it, you know, Jesus said if you have childlike faith, it'll work out. Well, that's childlike faith. God told us to do it. Why doubt it? And honestly, I never have doubted it. Has there been times where I wondered, okay, how are you going to do this? Like, I guess the greatest example to me was October of 2011, when God said we'd buy the land, pay cash for it, and we didn't even know where the land was the next year. And by March, we had the
a few months.
Yeah, in a few months, March of 2012, you guys, we'd raised the money, we'd bought the land, paid for it, all the perk tests done, everything done. I was like, wow. But when he first said that, and I had to speak it out to you guys back then, that was kind of one of the times it was kind of frightening, because none of us want to end up with egg on our face. Mm-hmm. And but that's part of faith, is being able to speak what God puts in your heart, and don't let nobody put water on that. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Y'all are both getting on in years.
I like it. It don't bother me.
She's older than I am.
I am. I'm almost 53. See, I won't be till July, but I'm already claiming it. So I'm different. I'm telling you, stay here.
Different. Yep. Yeah. What advice would you give to your 30-year-old selves?
Oh, my gosh.
I can answer that one real quick. Not take myself so serious. The older I get, the more I realize, lighten up. And you have to tell yourself that. I was riding my bike down here today, and I knew this was going to be a big celebration. I'm excited about it. And I started feeling that. I'm like, wait a minute. This is what we do. This is family. We're coming together to celebrate 15 years of family, 15 years of what God's doing. And you just settle yourself down to it. So my advice would be, look to the future. And not sweat the small stuff, and really just believe God. Yeah. Believe God. And try to be the lesson I've learned over the years. I started out at 18 years old in the business world, and many of you have heard this testimony, is they really coached me into being something that I wasn't. Mm. And it took me years to get out of that. Mm. And one of the greatest things that I'm learning, and I'm not there, but I am learning this, is to be Danny Dillard. There's nobody else like me. Aren't you glad? Yeah, usually that gets a laugh. I mean, they're like, yeah, thank God. but there's nobody else like you. That's one thing I love about, we give out a bunch of Andrew's books, and that's one thing I love about Andrew Womack. It doesn't matter where Tessa, stand up. Yeah, come on, stand up. For those that don't know it, turn around and face you. Yeah, she loves this as much as BB. This is Tessa Pittman, and I don't know about the title, but I'm going to give you one. Dean's right hand, Dr. Radke, that I've been traveling with. This is his, I guess, administrative assistant, or is that good enough? Right hand, does everything, Girl Friday, Sheila to him, you know, that kind of, yeah, y'all get that. Thank you for being here. And that's her sister, Tanya. It's good to have you here. Tessa's originally from Lexington. We used to go to church together, all of us. And then she went to Phoenix because it was warmer. Dean thinks it was because of him. Not really. But she works in office and with Dean on events and stuff. And a lot of you have met her, but I wanted y'all to know who she was. And so good to have you here with us. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember what I was saying after that, so if you've got anything, please share it.
Advice for the 30-year-old?
Oh, yeah, Andrews. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
She can tell she's been around Dean. Good. She remembered. He asked that a lot, doesn't he? What was I saying? Yeah. I get it. Andrew Womack, one of the things I've noticed, and I noticed it at camp meeting 2 years ago, I've followed him a little bit over the years, but in the last few years really followed him closely. This church sows into that ministry. And what I have noticed is he's the same all the time. It blew me away when I was at camp meeting because they had outside boonies there, you know, for the restrooms, and he's in this Brush Harbor thing, and I'm thinking this guy's got a potential audience of like, you know, 3 or 4 billion people around the globe, and he steps out there and he starts teaching, and I'm like, he didn't change a bit for this. He's exactly the same. And then if you see him at a business summit somewhere, he's still the same. And that's the goal that we all need to obtain. And let me just say this. God's okay with you. He's okay with you. He loves you. He wants the best for you. You don't have to impress nobody. Amen? Go ahead. Take us somewhere.
The advice for the 30-year-old.
Yeah.
It would be to enjoy the moment. Now, like I said, I don't really plan far out, but I am an organized person, and so it's real easy for me to be doing this and thinking about what I've got to do after a while. So it would be slow down, because life does go by fast. When I think 30, I think, well, I was just 30 the other day, but no, it's been a while. So it's enjoy the moment.
And I still think I'm 30. Actually, yeah. 25, but go ahead. Yeah.
As pastors, what is your greatest joy and your deepest sorrow? Greatest joy and deepest sorrow.
You want me to, or you?
Well, you can start. I mean, it
okay.
Or I can.
Go ahead.
Start
talking.
Greatest joy. seeing people. I love seeing everybody's smiling faces and just being together. I know. When we stopped Wednesday night for a while and went to home Bible studies, I told him, I said, I miss the Wednesday night. Yeah, it's easier sometimes to do the other, but I miss the people. And I try to get around. Now, this makes me a little uncomfortable. Once I get started, I'm all right because I can talk and talk and talk. But I do better the one-on-one. But I really enjoy talking to people. If I had my way, I'd probably visit everybody every week or something. But with my job like it is, I don't have that to do. And I, you know, what's my job with what I'm doing, which I feel the Lord's got me helping the elderly folks that I clean for and all, once that changes, I'd like to think that maybe I'll be doing more. I don't know with the membership, but that's something that's really near to my heart. And the deepest sorrow would have to be the flip side when people leave. It's tough, and you know that it happens. Over the years, we can think back, you know, and it's, you know, but you know that people have to do what God tells them to do, and we always wish everybody well, and you know, God just puts us where we need to be, and so that would be it.
Yeah, I think for me it's kind of similar. As a pastor, nothing that is greater excitement to me than to see people latch onto the Word of God, whether that be someone come up and give their heart to the Lord today, or someone get filled with the Spirit, or someone get a revelation that God's got them. Whatever the case may be, just to see God's people grow excites me. The flip side of that would be when I see people not doing that. I've learned over the years that's not my issue. I can't go there. All I can do is teach what God gives me to teach. And that's part of being who I am. That was the part that really helped me get free from some of the other stuff, because I used to think that it was my responsibility as the pastor to straighten it out for them. That's exhausting. That was becoming my greatest sorrow. Why? Because we're all big boys and girls. We all get the Word of God, and we all grow at different times and different ways, but just letting people be people. And so, again, my greatest joy is to see people receive ministry and get where they need to be, and either leaving or not getting that is a sorrowful thing, too.
If you could, Lord, if you could only pick one scripture or principle that you shared with everybody for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Go ahead.
Well, my favorite is the Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will direct your paths. And I found that scripture when I was going through divorce, and I was so confused over, what now, God? Because I grew up in a church where you did not divorce, and if you did, you certainly didn't remarry. I was 29 when my first marriage ended, and It was a very confusing time because everybody that I had grown up and respected in the church world was telling me I had to take him back or you know, I'd just be alone forever. And that was I told the Lord, I said, if that's what I got to do, I'll do it. But it was a difficult time. But I found that scripture. I'm sure I'd probably read it before, but it jumped off the page. And I just started clinging to that. And it, through it all, meeting Danny, because we didn't meet for... I think I'd been divorced almost 5 years when we got married, and as you know, we dated 4 months. So. But, you know, I had a guy that I think God sent my way just to give me somebody to talk to after I'd talked to the Lord about this whole remarriage thing, of course. I didn't do anything until he helped me in Scripture figure that out. But that Scripture really just helped me not to worry about the future and just to go whatever he did. And I remember the night that... he had called me. We were going to meet the next day. I think I cried about all night. Like, God, what is going on in my life? And so it was just, I don't know. I just held on to that, and it got me through. And even now, it's very dear to my heart.
Yeah. Mine, it's so hard for me to do one, but I guess if I was to do the one that's meant the most to me, and I believe it means the most to people if they can grab a hold of it, is 2 Corinthians 5:17, old things pass away, behold, all things become new. To really understand that when the enemy comes to me and you know and says, well, you remember when you used to do this nonsense or you used to do this, I have to remind him that person died, the new one rose with Christ. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's so powerful. That God didn't put up, and this is what the Lord said to me 20 years ago when I started in ministry, started my walk with him, is he didn't put up, he said, I'm not going to put a Band-Aid on your life, I'm going to fix it. Yep. Now, I didn't realize there was going to be a lot of things being tore off. You know, when God says, I'm going to prune you, that just sounds really lovely. Until you go grab some pruning shears and start trying to get a limb cut, and then you're like, wow, that could be painful. You know, and it is painful, but here's the reality. I know, and that's what I want to relay to you every time we get together, who you are in Christ. Because it's not about just me knowing who I am. It's about you knowing who you are. You're a brand new creation. And even when the enemy tries to put something different or you try to put something different on yourself, you just claim that. And the other one, the two that saved my life was Romans 8:1, now therefore there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Those two scriptures, I had to look in the mirror for the first several months of my walk with Christ and read them out loud because I had so much guilt and shame, even on my face, for all the nonsense I had done. I went through divorce, and it was so much my fault in the sense of I was just a maniac out there. Drugs, well, I ain't no use to go into all that. You name it, as I've said, anything prior to 96, somebody says I done, don't argue with them. You know, just say he got born again. And that way keep egg off of your face. But hold on to those scriptures. You know, you're new. There's no condemnation in Christ. It doesn't matter what you've done. You're free. Once you've accepted Christ, and I trust you have. If you hadn't, that's the great exchange. You got to make that exchange for everything else to work out. You got to give your sins and receive his righteousness.
You've talked about how you had to change your confession about flying. Can you, both of y'all, give us another example in your life of victory over a fear or a personal challenge and the way you overcame it?
Well, I'll give her some time to think about this one. I'll just go on the one flying because this has been the freshest testimony. And Tess, I don't even know if you know this or not, but up until the time I started, me and Pastor Ed flew to Colorado the first time to be with Tessa and Dean and all of those folks out there. We left at lunch. We had lunch with Nicholas and Winston. We left, and we checked in the motel in Woodland Park the next morning at 5:30. That's a four-hour flight, okay? And then I get up to take a shower, and we were going to go get something to eat, and something attacked me. And we're sitting in Wendy's, and Ed's wondering if they're going to have to fly me out of there or what, because I break out in this cold sweat, and I just about to check out in the sitting at the table at Wendy's. And cold sweat, I don't know what's wrong. and got something to eat, and I was fine. Well, after that trip, I'd been saying for the last 15 years, I hate to travel, I hate to fly. And I hadn't flown prior to that. It had been almost 15 years ago when I was with Bulls Furniture going to the stores in Florida. And so it had been a long time. Now, years prior to that, I'd flew some. And so I just kept saying that. I'd come back from that trip, got another one coming up. Man, I hate to travel. And I was saying this for a couple of weeks just out loud. And the Lord just said so kindly and nicely to me, he said, I would change my confession. How many of you know when you hear stuff like that in your spirit, it's a good idea to grab a hold of it? I love to fly. And now it's not a matter of just saying that. I really have favor. And the trips have been nothing. Even the last one with Wyoming, I had to leave. This was kind of weird, but I had to leave TSA security and then come back through it to get to the next gate. And I thought that was weird, but the whole time I'm smiling, I'm like, I got TSA pre, I'm trucking through here, it's all good, I'm catching the plane. And it didn't bother me. So that's been my biggest thing to change my confession, the one you mentioned. I hope that's okay that I've done that.
I'm trying to think of the scripture. You'd actually had me share this not long ago. Maybe you can think of the scripture. It's not coming to me. But and y'all may have heard this already. I'm sorry to repeat it. But anxiety has been an issue for me in traveling. Never like to leave the house. I don't mean leave the house in the sense that I don't go to work, but I'm talking about to go on a trip. Now, I can go to work. I can go places like that. Never am bothered, but prior to this scripture coming to me, if we were going to go even on a 1 or 2 night trip, anxiety was just huge on me, come on me, fear of dying before I got home, even to the point of writing letters to the kids in case I didn't make it back. That kind of gave me a sense of peace. Now, Danny knew I didn't like to leave home, but I had never really shared with him the whole deal. But because I knew, I have to pick on him. Anytime I share anything, he's like, have you prayed? I'm like, yes, I've prayed. So he's like this at home, okay?
What are you standing on? You know, what are you standing on?
I'm like, I'm just trying to stand. But I would always pray, and I'd leave the house. I'm like, God, I'm going with you. But it was last summer. We were going to the beach for just a few days because, like I said, I'm not really big on leaving for days and days. But the Lord gave me a scripture, and I hate that it's just not coming to me, but I could find it if I had my phone or I've got it at home. I've got this little treasure box with scriptures, and it's the one in the front. Two, it's something about the Lord going with you to and fro. Mm-hmm. Well, scripture, just like the trust in the Lord thing, it just pops off the page, and y'all know what I'm talking about. It just pops off, and you know that's for you. Well, that scripture is in Psalm, I think. Mm-hmm. But it popped off, and I'm like, that's what I've been waiting on. God, I've got it. And so I can honestly say, now, I haven't traveled a lot since then. I guess we've been on a couple of trips. Yeah. But that fear, it's gone. That fear is not there because I say that scripture. I read that. And I guess to say that is, I really, really, my whole life of living with the Lord is, the Bible is huge, huge. If you've got anything bothering you, get your Bible. With the phones nowadays, Google, whatever's bothering you, and scriptures will come up. But turn through the Bible, find ways to do that, because that has been what's got me through everything. Yeah. I mean, there's always a scripture in there. It might take, like me with that, digging a little bit harder to find it. But I can honestly say the fear of the traveling is not there like it was. I still don't want to leave my babies, and I'm talking about my fur babies, okay? But, and then my job and all that, I like being home. I like home. I told Danny that's kind of a good thing, though, to say that I'm content. I'm happy at home. But, you know, the scripture really set me free from that. And if you're struggling with anything, find you a scripture you can stand on and just repeat it to yourself. And even if you're doing like me and you couldn't turn to it this minute, you've got the message. You've got the message. I know that to and fro, he's with me.
What do y'all think is the biggest misconception about being a pastor in general, and then about you in particular?
People's biggest okay. They don't have any. They think I'm wonderful and perfect. Is that the answer? Yeah. I think it's not just being a pastor. I think it's life in general. This came out accidentally in our meeting. Not this question, but this what I'm about to tell you came out accidentally in our meeting Friday. I had preached it the last Sunday. We don't look at people as they are. We look at them as we are. And so the misconception, it's not just about pastors, it's about anything. Well, if I was doing it, I wouldn't do it that way. Why? Because I haven't had them experiences. I remember when we first started out, BB grew up in a small rural church, well, different ones. And that was back when the pastor mowed the yard, painted the church, whatever else he done, and visited everybody no matter what was going on. Somebody hiccup, let's go see how they're doing. Somebody get a, cough. Let's go check them out. And so when we first started, I mean, I had a mindset to raise up leaders, and we've done that, as you've seen this morning, with whatever. All hey, let's give all of them a hand clap. Yeah. Wow. I chose not to steal from people. And you guys, I haven't done anything except hang out this morning other than this. This is what God called me to do. And so the big misconception even for her was, why are you not like what I grew up with? Mm-hmm. But see, that goes back to being who you're supposed to be. Mm-hmm. It's got to be good with you in the Holy Ghost. I don't have time, but I can name case after case where I did get impressed by the Lord to call someone, to drop in on someone. One guy, he's not here any longer. He's still here on earth, though, thank God. But I remember calling him that day, and it was just the Holy Spirit said, call him. And I didn't know this till a couple months later. He said, I was about to end it that day. See, when we follow the Holy Ghost, Jesus said in John chapter 17 of Gospel of John, he said, I'm going to leave you a comforter. He's going to lead you into all truths. He said, and he's going to guide you. He's going to direct you. And when he does, it's miraculous. Trust the Holy Spirit to speak to you. And then don't worry about people's misconceptions. It's not that you don't want people to, we all want people to love us. But you can't get hung up on people's misconceptions about who you are. You got to know who you are in Christ. Amen?
I try not to think about stuff like that. Yeah, no. I guess my mind went back to when I first realized I was going to have that title of pastor's wife. And so I'm going to turn it around with that. What I thought that meant was she had to do everything just right and make sure that everything, I don't know, the family was perfect, the church was perfect, and everything. And so I don't think people think that, but that's the only thing I think of when I first become a pastor's wife. And about me personally, I don't know. I try not to think like that. When I get nervous and I get thinking, and I've told Danny this before, just be yourself. And it's easier to say when I'm talking, he's going to be up here. But like when he asked me about doing this earlier in the week, I told him, I said, I don't want to know what it's about. Just get me up there. I don't want to know anything because I don't like to prepare. I just soon just start talking. Whatever comes down, as I say, I ramble. But, and I've lost my train of thought. Where was I going with that?
The Holy Spirit had spoke to you earlier that week before I asked.
When he asked me the other day about doing this, I said, well, I don't like to tell him everything sometimes, but I said, honestly, a few weeks ago, I was thinking, because he's always wanting me up here a little bit. And I said, well, I thought, well, if I did the hot seat, that's the thing they'd done in their teams, I could do that. I could answer questions. But anyway, so it was kind of cool the way God had prepared me. I had no idea. But the thing about the misconceptions, I mean, that's where I was going with it. I try not to think like that because whenever I really get nervous about getting up here and I think, well, people will see me talking and everything, I have to stop and tell myself, okay, you are who you are. Whether you're up here or you're down there, they see you. So, hello, whether you see me up here or down there, it's the same thing, you know. So I have to just tell myself to get through it. So if you're dealing with anything like that, just know, we love you. And I know he was a little nervous one time getting up to do something at one of the meetings. And
Andrew was sitting there, I remember.
Yeah, oh, yeah, he was. And I'm not one that says God said, but that morning I was thinking about him, and I thought, you know, I just need to tell him, be yourself, people love you. And I told him that, and he told me later that helped him so much. So I'd say that to you guys. Be yourself. We love you. Yeah. So, you know, but But that's just kind of...
Yeah, and let me hitchhike on that just a moment for you guys to always remember this. That morning in that motel, and two things happened, and both of them were directed by the Holy Spirit. I was nervous. I mean, here's all my... Dr. Racky's there. One, been a mentor of mine for 15 years. We met 15 years ago. He's right here beside me on the stage. I've got to deal with that. But sitting right there is the pastor of the church, which I highly respect, and then Andrew Womack. And my nerves was... I went back to what my first mentor told me. He said, it's okay to have butterflies, just get them flying in formation. Well, I was having a problem getting them flying in formation because I wanted to. I just didn't want to show up. Would have been easier. And but that morning, the Lord spoke to me, and he said this. He said, I've called you to take care of him, talking about Dr. Racky. This ain't about you anyway. And I love that. It just took all the pressure off of me. And then just a few minutes later, I get the text from her, just be yourself. People love you. And that's what I want to say to you is two things. One, be yourself. But also, when God gives you a word for somebody else, let's get over this stuff about missing God. Just give it to them. Yeah. Let's be grown up enough to know if it don't fit, who cares? Yeah. I mean, it'd be no different than you giving somebody, I mean, it could be more serious. But on the same token, if they're sincerely chasing after God, they're not going to take direction that's not from God. So even if you miss it, they still have to be mature enough to follow it. But we need to have more boldness with that. You don't have to say, thus saith the Lord. Just say, I'm feeling this. I wanted to share it with you. And sometimes this can change a person's life completely. So just be encouraged by that. You're with someone and you're like, I need to say this, but I don't know. Well, don't put so much pressure on yourself. Just say it. And you'll be effective minister for Jesus Christ. And that's what we're all called to do. Go ahead.
This question just got handed to me. Besides Pastor
Sheila. We don't answer those questions.
Besides Pastor Sheila, what's the best thing about pastoring LifeWay Church?
Can't think of anything. Was that the last question?
No.
Oh, okay. Besides Pastor Sheila. Y'all give her a hand clap. Isn't she wonderful? Yeah. You guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, not Pastor Ed. You guys, all of you.
Good people. That's what I think when I think of the church. Yeah.
Good people. I say this anywhere I go, and I still believe it. It's the greatest church in the world. And it's not because I'm the pastor. It's because God's doing something very unique here. And guys, we honestly, and I'm careful how I say this because I don't want to freak you out. I don't want to choke you with a vision. But I feel like right now we're just now getting started. We're just now getting started. All this other has been a dress rehearsal for what God wants to do in this church. I don't know if you know how phenomenal it is what y'all are doing, just building the building debt free and still loving each other through it. You wouldn't believe how many negative words I've had spoke over me about building a building. Well, you know that's going to split the church. Well, you know that's going to be the life of the pastor. You can't do that. Oh, everybody's going to be fighting like cats and dogs. Says who? History? Why don't we go with God? God said, if you'll take the steps, I'll build the church. I still believe him. That's the simplest word he ever gave me. He gave it to me at 5:30 in the morning, crying out to him at West End of Street. There's no reason to go back and ask him if he changed his mind. He said, I change not. He said, take the steps, I'll build the church. And so this, to me, is the greatest thing. It doesn't get any better than this. You guys are awesome. You agree? I think it was your cue.
Now, about two more questions, okay?
Yeah, I'm good. Okay.
What kind of legacy do you want to leave?
It's funny you asked that. I was thinking about it this morning. I don't remember exactly how I was going to say it, but I was going to speak about what I wanted the church to look like when I was gone, and it was like the Holy Spirit gently rebuked me. Don't stop thinking there. I want to get the training that I've learned in the world and from Dr. Ratke about leadership. I want to get that in people so well that when I'm long gone, if the Lord tarries, I mean, who knows? Jesus could come back today while we're eating pecan pie. I mean, you know, we don't know that. But if he tarries, I want this church to be a church that always walks in leadership in such a way that we're always moving forward, even when some people decide not to go with us. See, we don't back up. We don't change our direction. We stay with the vision. And I believe that there'll be a lot of churches that, and the Lord said this to me years ago, that we're not just a runner, we're a forerunner. I want to be able to stand in front of a group of people and say, yeah, we built debt free and we done it with our sense about us. We done it loving one another, loving people, loving God, experiencing a new life, and just a good legacy of not so much turmoil. People have plenty of turmoil in the world. You say, well, how do you keep that out of church? Well, you just make a decision you're not going to participate. People think things, people feel things, and whatever, but we just purpose in our heart that we're going forward. How many of you is with me? It'd be a good time to say, hoo-ah. How you say, hoo-ah. Heard, understood, and acknowledged. Go ahead.
My thought is kind of like, and you teach this, it's for
you
people
listen?
That know. I do. I'm more than you know. No, I do. I've learned a lot, by the way, by your teaching. But that it's relationship with Jesus, not just a formality. It's a day in and day out relationship. And he's there for you in the good, the bad, and the ugly, as they'd say. And you teach that. And I grew up, like I said, in church. I'm so thankful for my upbringing in the church I grew up in, very much. It was legalistic, which with my personality, I don't mind rules, so it didn't bother me too bad. But I know that's not the Bible way. And so I've seen that, and I'm thankful for God showing me that. But it is, I can tell the difference now from when I was growing up under the legalistic way. And one example is in school, I would not talk to people about Jesus because the church I grew up in, we couldn't wear makeup or jewelry. Well, I would look at a friend of mine, and if I thought they were not going to lay down their makeup or jewelry, I wouldn't even waste my time talking to them. Now, that's sad when you think about it, okay? There's no relationship there that I had that was a healthy relationship about the Lord. Yeah, I was saved, but I was confused on things. But the difference now is you talk to people about a relationship with Jesus, and he loves that person where they're at, whatever. Yeah. And so that would be the thing that I'm the most proud of, is that we teach that here, and I've gotten it myself, and I'm so thankful for it. He's with us every day, everywhere, at all stages of our life, and I'm thankful for that.
That's good.
For this last question, I have channeled my inner Oprah. She always asks her guests this, and I think, I don't like the show, but it's a good question. What do you know for sure?
I'm supposed to be here. And when I say I'm supposed to be here, I feel good about not just pastoring this church, dad, husband, granddad, assistant Dr. Ratke, and where he goes, because God told me to do it. I feel good about that. Do I have to fight off insecurities like everybody? Yeah. But I know down in here. This is Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you. To prosper you, to give you an expected end. Now, if you listen to the naysayers and if you listen to the world, they'll talk you out of that. So I made a decision years ago. I'm not going to give that airtime. People say, well, that's kind of rude, isn't it? No, I'll tell them about Jesus. I'll tell them about the word. But beyond that, you're not talking me out of what God told me to do. That's too important. I was thinking, I rode down to Ellis Park and I came around Ennis Street and I looked in the windows of both buildings and I remembered all the people that got saved, all the people that got healed, got filled with the Spirit. And I'm thinking, wow, how can I let somebody talk me out of this? Mm-hmm. Don't let them talk you out of what God told you to do. That's what I know.
It would be that... that Jesus does love me and he's for me. If I mess up, he's still for me.
Yeah. Even when you cuss.
Well, now explain yourself.
For those that haven't heard it, my wife accepted Christ when she was 7, but all of her friends, she had heard them curse.
Well, she got bold.
You can tell it better, can't you?
I got to tell him, because you may.
I might mess it up. He might teach the word of God, but I can't tell her story.
No, you can't. It was my story. It happened, honest to God. Y'all know me. I ain't exaggerating. I ain't lying. It's God, honest truth. I was about 7 or 8 when I first got saved. All right. And the way I knew I got saved, I quit being mean to my meemaw. I have thought back on that, and you may laugh, but you think about a 7 to 8-year-old. I mean, really, what big difference is going to happen? And I used to beat myself up because I hadn't lived in the world and done some great big thing I could talk about. And I thought, well, that's twisted. But anyway.
She hadn't worked on her testimony out there.
I hadn't worked on my testimony. So
I worked on mine enough for both of us, okay?
But I was thinking about one day, and I thought, God, I remember where I was at when I asked you to forgive me of my sins. But my mama's mama, I was so mean to her. She kept me all the time. And I know y'all think, little girl being mean, but my daddy's mama, she'd get you with a switch. She had to go get you on the switch and that kind of thing. But my meemaw was a pushover. Ed remembers my meemaw. Sweet, sweet lady. All right, but when I got saved, I can remember a time, and it was in that same time period, so I know that was probably my transformation. I remember a time screaming at my meemaw, and it just come all over me. You don't need to do that no more. And I didn't do it anymore after that. And I got thinking back on that. And I truly believe that was a little girl's conversion with the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I didn't think much more about Jesus then. I just went to church. I heard about him and all that. But when I was in, it would have been the 7th grade. I was like 13. I'd always been picked on playing sports. I was horrible at it. Still don't like it. It's not my thing. Okay, but you know, back then, they would pick you on teams. I was always the last. I knew I was going to be still a sore spot. I'm sorry. But anyway, now I feel sorry for people. It was hard. But anyway, I had it built up in my mind that if I would be cool and cuss like the other kids, I would become popular, okay? So when they called my name, I blast, and then I had to go up, and of course, I was the 3rd strikeout, so we had to go out in the field. So I decided that was my big moment. And I said a humdinger of a bad one, okay? But the crazy thing is, when I get out to the, what do you call it, out in the
outfield.
Field? Outfield. I'm going through there, and I'm thinking, I cussed. I said a bad word, okay? The Lord, and I'm not exaggerating, because I hadn't been thinking about Jesus this whole time I was going to cuss. I wasn't out there praying, God, make them like me. And I was going to cuss so I'd be cool. So I'm going across the field, and I promise you not, I'm taking you to the ball field. It's in Austinville, Virginia.
It, yeah.
I showed him. It's just like the heavens rolled back. And all I remember, I was not thinking about God other than use his name in vain to be cool. The heavens rolled back, and God said to me, now don't you feel like an idiot. I'm the only one that heard you. And now that was a sobering moment. It was. Not only, I mean, it's kind of humorous, but I want you to know that was a sobering moment. Because I'm standing in that ball field like, you did. Nobody else did, but you did. And I declared right then, never again would I cuss. But that was it. But that's been my relationship with God. He has just talked to me like that. And I don't know how I missed that during that legalistic training that I had. I don't know how I missed that. Because when I would just get alone, we would talk like that. I got to tell this one. When I was, I'll get going. I told you now. Don't give me a microphone. But I remember when we had moved from Virginia to North Carolina, it was hard on me. I was shy, and it was hard coming down here. But I always talked to Jesus. After, you know, I purposed in my heart I was going the way with him, not cussing anymore. So I remember going out and sitting in our car in the garage one night because I needed to talk to Jesus, and I didn't want to do it in the house where people might hear me. I needed time, and I don't know what Mom, I don't think Daddy was traveling on his job, so I don't know what Mama thought. But anyway, she's like, whatever, she's going outside. But I remember sitting there, don't even know what was wrong with me, don't have a clue. But I remember just saying to Jesus, I wish I had an older brother to talk to. And I was crying over whatever, and he said to me, not audibly, but I've never forgot it. I was sitting in the back seat of the car, and he said, I am your big brother, talk to me. And so I've just had that with him, and I'm so, so thankful for that. I got sidetracked with my legalistic thinking, but I've had that with him, and it is so, so special to me. And there's other things I won't share. But if you are struggling today with your relationship with him, just know he loves you. He hears you. He sees the hurt, the pain, all of it. And as Mama said to me one time when I was going through the divorce and I was very angry over something, she said, "Have you told the Lord your anger?" I said, "Well, not in so many words." She says, "Well, you need to just tell him. He already knows." And I remember just lashing out then. And that helped me because, you know, and so I'm thankful for that. And so if you're dealing with anything, just get in a quiet spot and just give it all to him. And just know he loves you and he's for you no matter what. He already knows it.